Welcome to episode 3 of Research Without Tears. In this episode, we're going to begin to look at the question, what is a scholarly source? Because in all of my classes, I emphasize that I would prefer that students use scholarly sources rather than going out and finding whatever they can find on the internet. So the first thing I think to have you understand is that historical research on the internet can be good, but very often it's very derivative. That is, somebody puts up a page and they've taken information from other sources which they may or may not cite, and that's a problem in and of itself, but it's usually not the cutting edge research, it's usually not by the people who know the most about the topic, and it's often really, frankly, not that good. So a scholarly source is what I'm really encouraging you to go out and find. So what is that? A scholarly source is generated by someone who has historical knowledge, probably has either a background in academic history or maybe one of the independent scholars who does historical research and writes more popular work. But in any case, any of those people would use widely accepted historical methods for research. Those historical methods can be varied. They can include doing primary research among documents. They can include archaeological research. They can include a lot of different techniques. But scholarly research doesn't push an opinion without backup data to justify the opinion. It can surface possibilities. It may even favor an interpretation. But it always gives evidence, it always gives that backup data to justify that opinion or that suggestion. Scholarly sources also are accepted by others who have credible qualifications as convincing in a field, even if the evidence is controversial. Other scholars may agree or disagree with it, but if they take it seriously enough to say, well, you know, here is evidence that seems to indicate that. There's evidence that indicates something that's different from that, but this is serious enough research so that we take it seriously. That's a scholarly source. So how do you see one? How do you recognize one when you see one? An acceptable scholarly source might include any of the following. A peer-reviewed journal in history or a related subject. Peer review means that somebody who has good history credentials blind reviewed somebody's paper and passed judgment on whether it meets scholarly criteria or not. So that's usually a great source. University presses usually publish books that are credible and by people who are at least in the conversation or have some qualifications and credibility in the field. So that's a second scholarly source. A third scholarly source would be those independent scholars. They may not be associated with a college or a university. I can think of someone who did really excellent work on the Civil War, but he had a lot of credibility because he used such excellent methodology when he was doing his research. And fourthly, a scholarly source might be an expert who has subject-specific knowledge. Maybe somebody who's an Ohelone native person hasn't written published books about the Ohelone, but has a lot of oral history and family knowledge about that specific subject. So that would be fine. So generally, you want to go to the original scholarly source rather than reading about a scholarly source in a secondary source. And we'll talk in class about how to cite when, you know, if you have somebody who is quoting somebody else, that's a whole particular MLA citation, but it's always better to go to the original. And then there are some sources that are definitely not acceptable as scholarly sources. You can probably think about for yourself what some of these are. One would be The Onion. You can't use The Onion, although students have tried. Wikipedia is not a scholarly source. It can be a great starting point to find other original sources because it often has a bibliography or it has other search terms. But in and of itself, Wikipedia I generally don't want to see in your papers. A third unacceptable source would be K-12 school sites. Many schools put up research pages, but they're really for fourth graders. They're not for college students. And ditto, another unacceptable source would be children's books. You can get a lot of information for children's books, but think of them sort of how you think of Wikipedia. It's a starting point to give you some direction for where to go next, but in no way is it going to be acceptable in a college paper as a credible source. Student videos are kind of in that same category, or student papers from other colleges, not really the best sources. And company websites sometimes have a little bit of useful information, but usually corporate websites are trying to sell an image or sell a product, so they're usually not considered the best sources by scholars. And if all of this is overwhelming and you just don't know and you're in doubt, by all means, ask me or ask a reference librarian, you know, does this seem like a scholarly source? It's not that you can never use a source that isn't from Harvard or Stanford. It's that I really want you to learn to differentiate between a scholarly source and one that's really a popular source, and to see the quality difference in the information in those two kinds of sources. So I'm hoping that you'll focus on finding those scholarly sources and get help if you need it.